What is electronic design? Okay, all of us have been studying design all these days and teaching design all these days. We must ask ourselves the question, what do you mean by electronic design? What is this activity called electronic design? Okay, there is no book answer or correct answer for this that you write, you know, like they say, what is physics? Physics is the science of matter, energy and their interactions. Correct, 2 marks. None of this. Okay, this is, we have to apply our minds and think, what is design? What is electronic design? And as I said, there is no only correct answer, whatever you feel. This is my answer to this question. Okay? So, my answer is this, that given specifications, there is no electronic design if you are not given accurate specifications. Specifications must be complete. So, given specifications, we want to develop a circuit. And what is a circuit? By connecting known electronic devices. Okay? Such that the circuit meets the given specifications, right? That means what are specifications? Specifications are a description of the behavior of the circuit, okay? So, suppose you want somebody to design an 8085. So, you will say design a circuit which will read instructions like this clock circuit, it will put ALE high, ALE low, etc. You are describing behavior, okay? And then you will say when the instruction or this bit pattern is presented, it will move the contents of A register to B register, etc., etc., right? So, the specifications are essentially description of the desired behavior of the circuit. That is the starting point. What is the end point? I will say you connect this register to this and this register to this and connect this transistor here and put clock here, etc., etc. Then this circuit will have the behavior that you want. Correct? When that has been done, the design has been completed. Okay? So, this is my definition of what electronic design is. Now, there are many keywords here which we now have to understand. What are the keywords? First of all, we are saying known electronic devices, right? Where you stop the design, you don't have to go down to a single transistor. For example, you are doing a board design. Now, I need not go beyond a D flip-flop. I'll say, okay, use a 7474 here or use a 4013 here. That is where my design ends. Right? So, where does the design end? Where I reach an interconnection of devices which are already known. Right? Now, what is already known is a variable that depends on the context. For example, suppose I am doing VLSI design and my company already has a copy of the ARM processor. Then, if I am designing an MP3 player, then the ARM processor is a known component. I don't really have to design the ARM processor. I just put it in down and that is called IP core based design. So, essentially, if the known components become more and more complex, then I can design more and more complex circuits. Because my design stops when I reach a known component and an entire microprocessor is now for me a known component. Essentially, you are doing board design on a chip. Right? This is what you would have done on a board design. You would look at it and say, I think an 8051 will do it. Therefore, when does your board design stop? You don't have to design the innards of the 8051. You say, I'll put an 8051 here. And therefore, 8051 is a known component. Okay? So, once you reach known components and known components only, there is nothing unknown. Then your design is finished. So, that is one part there. The other part is specifications. You might make the charge that I have defined something in terms of something else which is as unknown. Okay, so what are specifications? My definition is not complete unless I have told you what are known devices and what are specifications. Right? So, known devices, we have now had a discussion, we have a good feeling of what known devices are. We should now know what we mean by specifications. Right? So, the specifications refer to the description of the desired behavior of the circuit. Right? Specifications must be complete. Right? So, you must have complete description. Unless this is complete, I may make something which has the specified behavior, but it may do other things which are quite bad and you may not be acceptable to you. Then my design is not complete. Okay? So, electronic design is the activity of connecting known devices to produce acceptable behavior and the starting point is the description of the behavior. Okay? Hardware description languages are designed to meet this requirement. Okay? Therefore, I need to mix two things which appear very incompatible with each other. One is a behavior description and the other is a simulation of a known circuit. Right? Circuits are described differently. Behavior is described differently. Circuits are diagrams. Behavior is some algorithm, some logic. Now, how can I merge these two and come up with something? That is what hardware description languages do. Okay? That is the purpose of hardware description languages. So, electronic design is the process of converting a behavioral description. What is the behavioral description? Which says what happens when kind of description. To a structural description. What is the structural description? What is connected to what? Right? And when the behavior of these two is the same, then my design is complete. Okay? That is electronic design. Now, what is the problem with this? Now, we have understood it. Now, electronic design is all complete. We can all go home. The problem is that designs have become very complex. Right? So, every year, new technology comes. In every 18 months, we can put twice the number of devices on a chip. And our market expects devices which are twice as complex every 18 months from us. And if we don't meet that expectation, we will be outdated. Okay, so new microprocessors come, they work at higher clocks, they have new memories come, they have higher capacity and so on. And if that expectation is not met, then no design is required. Okay, you will be out of business. So therefore, this complexity is now becoming very huge. The problem is, unfortunately, that the human mind is not improving at the same rate as the technology. Okay, and unfortunately, it is the human mind which is required to translate this behavior to circuit. So, how do I manage this? That is the major problem. So, the major problem of modern design is conquest over complexity. Okay? Now, one obvious way of conquering complexity is divide and rule. Okay? Rather than talking in the air, let's take a specific example. Let's say that somebody was to come and tell us, design an 8085. We all know 8085. It's not a big deal. It's a transistor, it uses 15,000 transistors. That is nothing compared to modern designs. Okay? A Pentium uses something like 10 to the power 8 transistors. About 100 million transistors, tens of millions or 100 million transistors. I'm not asking for much. I'm asking for 15,000 transistors. So, the expectation will be by this afternoon design the 8085 and that should be done. When the original designers of 8085 came together, they took about 15 man years. Okay, but at that time all these advanced tools were not there, right? So now with the modern tools, just do it, okay, don't take an afternoon, take a week. We are suddenly afraid, no, it may be a very simple circuit, but I can't up and design an 8085 like that. It's too complex. Okay, it may be only 13,000 transistors for you, but 13,000 transistors is too many for me. That is because the human mind has a limitation of handling a certain number of objects at a given time. And typically, ordinary, they may be geniuses, but ordinary human minds, they handle tens of devices at a time. Okay, not more than that. If you have more than 10 objects to handle, then it becomes just too complex for you. Okay, an example is a game of chess. I don't know how many of you play. So, in a game of chess, initially, there are 32 pieces there. That's too many for you to comprehend and to keep track of. So, therefore, initial moves are all stylized, somebody has worked it out painfully, etc. And you pick one out of 10 or 20 choices, right? So you want 10 or 20 choices, no more. You pick one out of them and then follow it. Till some mardhar occurs, the number of pieces is now reduced to about, say, 20. Now you can start applying your mind. Okay? So this is the trick. At a given time, handle no more than 10 to 20, right? So this is called hierarchical design. When a complicated design is given to you, break it up into no more than 10 to 20 parts. So, okay, you say 8085, you describe the behavior, all right. It has an ALU, okay, not very complicated. It has a register file. You told me that these are the registers, I need a register file. It has a certain way of reading from the bus. So, it has a bus interface unit, okay. It has an interface controller, all right. Now, it looks somewhat manageable, okay. So, I'll have a register file, I'll have an ALU, I'll have an instruction decoder, I'll have a bus interface unit, and now I have to figure out how to connect them. Okay, if I do all of this, then I have the design of an 8085, right? So, already I start feeling better that this task can be managed. So, the way to conquer complexity is by hierarchy, okay? And I go top down. Next, I say, all right, what is this? All right, I don't worry about other things. My team has been asked to design the ALU. So what does this ALU do? Not much. Just add, subtract, not even multiply. Okay? Just add, subtract some logic operations, and or XOR. Okay? That I know how to do. I know how to make an adder. I know how to convert an adder to a subtractor. I know how to do and or XOR. Not a big deal. Not is also okay. I know how to rotate. Then what else is there? Put all these things together. Your ALU is ready. Okay? Then somebody says, what about the register file? Not a big deal. I'll take 8 D flip flops and connect a gate at the input, gate at the output, connect it to the bus. If this register is to be loaded, then the input should be turned on. If this register is the source, then the output should be turned on. So I'll decode the address of this register. Okay, and there are 8 of these possibles. So I'll have a 3-bit code, and depending on whether it is input or 8 output, one of 8 switches need to be turned on. Register file is not a big deal. Okay, similarly decoder, similarly other things. You start doing it at that level, things start becoming manageable. And that is the only way that we can do complicated design. Therefore, a hardware description language should be one which allows you to work like this. Okay? You can't work at circuitry level, right? Whenever things become complex, then graphical descriptions become too difficult. Okay? Remember, how did all these languages, how did scripts evolve? Script evolves like a picture. Okay, you drew some picture of some concept and so on, that this is a man or this is sky or whatever. But soon it turns out that the complexity is so high that you can't use pictorial representations. Okay, similarly a circuit diagram is a pictorial representation of the actual circuit. Pictorial descriptions won't do. We need text descriptions. When things become complicated, things become abstract, then you need a language and not pictures. And as a result, the same thing is true of electronic design, that you go from circuit diagrams to hardware description languages when the complexity becomes too much. So that is what the hardware description language solves. So these are the things. You need hierarchical design. We have already established that with the 8085 example. You need modular architecture, so that once you have said ALU, it should not depend, ALU's design of ALU should not change if somebody changes the register file design. Right? So that different people can take on different things and quickly do it. So this design should be modular. It should be text based rather than pictorial. And you should be able to reuse existing resources. Okay? So suppose a register has been made, then tomorrow you want to design an 8051. You should not be required to start from scratch. Okay? You are not using the entire 8085 design, but your company has been very successful with an 8085. Let's say we go back 20 years and you are in Intel. Now you want to come out with 8051, you should not be required to start from scratch. Okay, register files are similar, ALU has similar functions, some additional functions, you should be able to compose it out of the same building bricks. Okay, so therefore each of these entity of design should be reusable. Okay, these are the requirements of a hardware description book, and we take a page out of the software designer's book, because this is what we have learned from software people. Software people have managed high complexity for a long time, and this is what they do. They use libraries, so you can reuse functions in different these things. You do hierarchical design. You have programs calling subroutines, calling other subroutines, and so on. You do hierarchical design. You have modular architecture. The change of one subroutine should not change another function, and so on. So all this is what we learned from software designers. Therefore, our description should resemble software. Unfortunately, this is taken too far. Many people teach hardware description language as if it is a programming language, and that way you are inviting disaster. Okay, because it is anything but. There is something to be learned from software. It is like a hardware description language does look, feel and smell like a software language, but it is anything but. It is very different from a software. And how is it different is the next thing that we should. Okay, we come to this, that hardware is actually different from software. Fine, we will learn from software, but that is not where we stop. There are other things. How is hardware different? Why is hardware description different? First, hardware components are concurrent. Software, things happen one after the other. Only one thing is happening at a time. Whereas in hardware, different blocks are operating all at the same time and interacting with each other. Okay? So to describe the behavior of something which is so parallel requires constructs which are inherently different from the constructs which are required to describe a sequential algorithm. Okay, so that is concurrency. Second, the behavior, the timing is a indivisible part of hardware description. Whereas timing is not, you know, you may have a slow computer, you may have a fast computer. The correctness of a program is determined by the result that it produces. Okay, may produce it in more time, may produce it in less time. Okay, but the programming language is not concerned about it. The hardware on which this language will run, that is separate. But the programming language need not be concerned with time. It never is. On the other hand, hardware crucially depends on time. Which pulse will come before the other can totally alter the behavior of your hardware. And therefore, it is not software. It is different, and these things must be incorporated into the very construction of the language. It should not be like a software program. And those who teach hardware description languages like a programming language are producing students who will be unemployable really, because they don't understand. They will often commit mistakes, and everybody commits mistakes, but the problem is that they will commit mistakes and never realize the kind of mistakes that they are committing. I will take perhaps a few examples of the kind of mistakes which are not understood by those people who teach hardware description like programming languages. Okay, so these hardware description languages need to have the ability to behave, you know, something may be described behaviorally. Some, let's say that the register file has already been described structurally. I have reduced it down to transistors. But my instruction decoder is described only behaviorally. Now, whether the whole thing is working or not, I need to put it all together. Right? So, therefore, I need to have a language which can put together elements where some are behavioral, some are structural, and overall mixed. Right? That capability must be inherent, and that's why hardware description languages always have behavioral and structural parts. I already said that timing is integral to hardware description, right? This is, by the way, there is one kind of software where timing is important, that's called real-time software. Okay? In fact, if you read any book on real-time software, they say it is like hardware because timing is important. Okay? For example, suppose you have a microprocessor. In the anti-locking brakes of a system, of a car, right? Now, this program determines the force to be applied to the brake pads, given the current situations. Now, it may arrive at the correct value, but not arrive at the correct value fast enough, and the car may crash. It doesn't help you very much that it finally found out how much pressure should have been applied to the pads, if by that time the car has crashed. So, when you have a system like that, then that's called a real-time system. Okay, and a hardware is always a real-time system. Hardware design is always real-time. So we must understand time, okay, or delay. Let's see, how do you describe delays? So here is the simplest possible example of a delay. You have a pulse at the input, and the output should be a delayed version of this pulse by 30 microseconds. Now, essentially, this is an example in VHDL, but don't worry about the actual structure. Almost in any language, this is what happens. I am saying out, assigned to out, the same waveform as in, but with a delay of 30 microseconds. Right? What do we understand from this in hardware terms? If we stopped at here, then we will really not understand hardware. Then we would be treating it like a programming language. Okay? So let us see. Suppose I open out this black box into its hardware constituents. And this is one possible way that I can put down the hardware. Okay? Let's say there is this RC delay with a delay of 30 microseconds and a buffer, right? This RC delay will lose the TTL logics or whatever logic levels because of the RC, right? The output will not be sharp anymore. Therefore, I need to put a buffer, okay? And RC will provide the delay. Now, this will meet my specifications of this circuit, right? The buffer is non-inverting. So, output is the same as the input with a delay of 30 microseconds. Or is it? Let's look at it. Let's say that I give it two pulses. The first pulse is much narrower than 30 microseconds. The second pulse is much wider than 30 microseconds. Okay? Now let's see what happens. This is an integrator. So when this pulse goes high, it starts integrating up. However, before it has gone much farther, this pulse goes low again. Right? As a result, this point being low, this capacitor now starts discharging through this right? So as a result, in 30 microseconds time, this will go up a little bit, but since the pulse did not last a full 30 microseconds, it will come down, okay? And therefore, this guy will treat it as if it has been zero throughout, right? So at the output, this little wiggle will actually disappear. On the other hand, if the pulse is much wider, then with a 30 microsecond time constant, this will charge up, stay there, and when the pulse comes down, it will start discharging. Now, because this acts as a discriminator of a low level and a high level, the output will be a nice square pulse somewhere depending on where the discrimination level is. And now you will get a delayed pulse, pulse delayed by 30 microseconds. Okay? So, a pulse much narrower than the delay has vanished. Now, this is how hardware behaves. Should we say that all delays are like this? Answer is no. Let's look at opening out that black box in a different way. Okay, this was my black box, delay of 30 microseconds. Now, instead of implementing my delay by that RC circuit, I implement it like this. Okay, I give it to an LED here. I have a long optical fiber whose length corresponds to a 30 microseconds delay. And then I convert this light back to digital level at the output. Right? This black box also should be described the same way. That output equal to in after 30 microseconds. Correct? Now let's see what is the behavior of this black box to the same input. Okay? Now of course this pulse will also appear at the output. Because there will be a flash of light which is brief. This light, flash of light will eventually appear 30 microseconds later at the other end of the fiber. And this longer flash will also appear as a longer flash at the end of the optical fiber. If that didn't happen, you would never be able to send messages from here to Delhi. The delay is so long, hundreds of kilometers, the delay is really long there, right? And yet pulses which last nanoseconds are sent. So in this case, the narrow pulse does not vanish. Okay? So therefore, there are delays and there are delays. We must describe these delays differently. Okay, so hardware is a strange object, should not be treated. If you just thought of it like software, you would have said that assign to this variable this value after so much time. Okay, but that won't do. In fact, the thing has changed qualitatively because of the way that the delay is implemented. Okay, so we must understand time very properly. And in fact, these delays are called inertial delay and transport delay accordingly, and you must specify it the same. Now, very often you are not worried about timing at the start of the design. Okay, you just want to know the correctness of your logic. So then, if you don't specify a delay, what should the hardware take in? Okay, now by default, the delay is taken as zero. Okay, the default value of delay, if you don't specify, is taken as zero. But that cannot be physically right. Okay. Because there may be race conditions, and if pulses arrive in different order, that will cause problems. So what a hardware description language actually does is that it takes zero delay to be a delta delay. Okay, the assumption is no hardware can update its output in zero time. Okay, there is a definite amount of time of delay from input to output. If you are not worried about it, then I agree to play along with you and I'll call it zero delay. But as far as my internal operations are concerned, I will define a special unit of time called a delta delay. Okay? So this delta delay is something whose value is reported to be zero when the final timings are reported. But as far as my internal operation is concerned, I will assume that all things which are a result of something, the delay between cause and effect, is always a delta delay at least. So if you say zero, I'll put it as a delta delay and keep detailed accounting that the time is 30 microseconds and 5 deltas. Okay? And then when you ask when did this happen, I will say it happened at 30 microseconds. At that time, I will put delta equal to 0. But for internal operation, I know that something which happened at 30 microseconds plus 2 delta occurred much earlier than 30 microseconds plus 5 delta. And there was a 3 delta time in between where one was true and the other was false. Okay, and if that has specific consequences, then I should take into account those kinds of consequences. For example, one input is coming to the clock, the other is going to reset. Did clock come first or did the reset come first? Okay, did clock go away first? Did reset go away first? Correspondingly, the output could be a 1 or 0. Okay, the overall delay can be 0, but the output result itself will become wrong if I do not take this scheduling into account. Therefore, I must have the concept of delta delay, which is special to hardware description languages. This, by the way, is the source of much headache to all the students who learn HDL as if it is a programming language. Okay? Because what happens is that you say assign 0 to A, and if A equal to 0, do this. Now, because they are so used to software, they feel that A equal to 0 is correct. Indeed, it is not. What, when you say assign 0 to A, A has not become 0. A 0 is scheduled to be given to A in the future, after a delta time. If you test the value of A before that delta has occurred, then you will find that it is actually non-zero. Okay? So these students, just like used to be used to software writing, say, but why is it misbehaving? I am saying assign 0 to A, and if A equal to 0, do this, and it is not doing it. Okay? That is because you have learnt hardware description like software, whereas it is not software. You have to take that into account and test the value of A only after the assignment is complete, only in the next delta. So therefore, the language has this responsibility now to remember to assign values in the future. When the assignment is encountered, it is not immediately assigned, right? So it keeps what is called a transaction register, a transaction queue. What is a transaction? It's like saying that I place an order, but the equipment arrives later. Okay? So that's a transaction. Somebody has to keep track that this order has been placed, this money has been paid, whether that thing has finally arrived or not. Okay? So this whole thing constitutes a transaction. Now the hardware description language keeps a time ordered list of transactions. Okay? And things are executed in the order of their time. So for example, if you have let's say an AND gate, one input is 1, the other input is 0. Now at some time, this 0 input goes to 1. Then the output should become 1, AND gate, the other input is 1. This has gone from 0 to 1, output should go from 0 to 1. You do not directly assign a 1 to the output. You have to take down a note that after a gate delay, make the output equal to 1. So during that gate delay, many other things may be happening all around the circuit. You have to do those first and then make the output of this AND gate 1. Otherwise, you will get wrong results. Right? So therefore, you need to have the capability of storing these pending events all the time. Okay? And that is called a transaction, a list of transactions. And you must understand it in terms of transactions. An assignment is not immediate. It's not like assignment to a variable. It's a transaction. Okay? So it's like a little black diary you have. So when somebody says, give 10 bucks, so you say, acha de denge, and you write down in your diary, give 10 bucks at this time. But your wallet still contains those 10 bucks. When the time comes, then you will give that 10 bucks. So if somebody says, if your wallet has more than this much amount, do this, or less than this much amount, then do this, then if it is treated like a programming language, you may come to the wrong result. Okay? So that is the difference between programming languages and hardware description languages. How do we handle concurrency, that many things are happening at the same time? Because after all, a program can do only one thing at a time. We are simulating it on a computer. So the computer can do only one thing at a time, whereas you want everything to happen at the same time. So the answer is that we have a separate variable called time, and we keep the value of this variable frozen. Now we can do all things, and only when everything is completed, we advance the value of this variable. As a result, even though we did that sequentially, as far as the time tracking is concerned, they would all have occurred at the same value of time, because the value of this time variable was kept frozen. Okay? So this is how, this is event-driven software always works like this. We discussed this for IRSIM also. So you have a time variable, you hold the time variable constant, you place a transaction when something comes, and then advance the time to the earliest next time when something needs to be done. Okay, so this is called event sensitive handling. So let us take this practical example. Okay, what do I have? I have a NAND gate here. There is one input which is direct and the other input which goes through an inverter. The inverter has a delay of 8 units, the NAND has a delay of 6 units. Okay, so I have a slow inverter, a fast NAND. Let's see what happens. Now, if you were to analyze it without time, then you will come to the wrong result. Right? Why? Because at least one of the inputs must be 1 and the other must be 0. Okay, if A is 1, then the other input is 0. If A is 0, then A is 0. So at least one of the inputs must be 0 at a given time. Therefore, the output, this being a NAND, output should always be 1. Okay? In reality, that is not so. What happens is that when A goes from 0 to 1, this becomes 1 immediately, but there is a delay of 8 units of time before this becomes 0. Therefore, for 8 units of time, both inputs are 1 and the output has a 0 going glitch. Okay? This example will illustrate how that glitch is correctly reproduced during simulation. Okay? Otherwise, if we treated it like a programming language, we will always come up as a logic simulator, we'll always come up with the wrong result. Okay? So that's why this example is illustrative. So I have a time ordered transaction list. What is a transaction list? This says make the input 0 at 0 time, make the input 1 at 20, this is also a transaction, and make the input 0 at 50. Right? These are the three transactions which are pending. So I enter them here in this transaction list and order them by time. At 0, make A equal to 0. I don't know what A was before. That is unknown. Okay? So at 0, make A equal to 0. At 20, make A equal to 1. And at 50, make A equal to 0 again. Okay? These are the only transactions that I know. What do? I first make a sensitivity list. Okay? This is what we had discussed for IRSIM also. We simulate only partial circuits. Only a circuit whose inputs have changed should be re-simulated. Right? So we notice that any event on A will cause re-simulation of the inverter as well as the NAND. Any change on A, then the output of the inverter and NAND must be recalculated. After recalculation, it may come out the same. That doesn't matter. But recalculation must be done. On the other hand, any change on B, only the NAND needs to be recalculated. Okay? So we say it by saying that inverter as well as the NAND are sensitive to A, whereas the NAND is also sensitive to B. Okay? And now we keep our time order here. Next, we advance the time to 0. Okay? Now at 0, what is the pending transaction? Make input equal to 0. Okay? So you update and make A equal to 0. Now the old value of A, B, C were unknown. New value of A is now 0. Therefore, A has had an event. Okay? A value has changed. Earlier it was unknown, now it is 0. Therefore, I must re-evaluate all gates which are connected to A. Who is sensitive to A? Both. Okay? So therefore, when I do the inverter, its delay is 8. So it says make B1 at 8 units of time. Current time is 0, delay is 8, input has become 0. Therefore, I calculate and say make B1 at 8 units of time. Correct? And when I evaluate the NAND, I don't care what the other input is. If one input has become 0, then the output must be 1. Right? I already know the output. So I say make C equal to 1 at 6 units of time. Right? These two I insert into my transaction queue. Right? And take out the transaction that I have already handled. So make A equal to 0, I take out. See, this is the transaction queue before and this is after. So I take out 0 and insert at 6, make C equal to 1, and at 8, make B equal to 1. And the remaining transactions remain. Got that? Then I am through with 0. What is the next earliest time at which something happens? 6. Right? This is the earliest time in my transaction queue. So at 6, what should I do? I should make C equal to 1, right? That is the diary that I, my diary says at when the time says 6, make C equal to 1. So that is what I do. The current time is 6. A was previously 0, now remains 0. B was previously X, remains X, right? But C should now be made 1 at 6, okay? And that nobody is sensitive to C. So no recalculation needs to be done. So I remove this transaction at 6, right? I have made C equal to 1, right? So notice this C has gone to 1 here. I am constructing the waveform here. A is 0 and remains 0, B is still X, and C has gone to 1 here, okay, at 8, at 6. Next, what is the earliest thing remaining? At 8. What should I do at 8? I should make B equal to 1, right? So at 8, B goes from X to 1, therefore B has had an event. Who is sensitive to B? Only the NAND, okay? So I must recalculate the NAND. So A is 0, B is 1, right? So what should be the output of the NAND? It should be 1. If either input is 0, output should be 1. So I schedule the value 1 at current time plus 6, right? The delay is 6. What is the current time? 8. So 8 plus 6, that means at 14, make C equal to 1, okay? I don't care if C is already 1. So I insert at 14, make C equal to 1. Notice that C is already 1, but I don't care. I insert that at 14 makes C equal to 1, and then I am done. I can remove this transaction, right? So this is my remaining transaction list. Now when is the next earliest time when something happens? 14, right? And what do I have to do? Make C equal to 1. So that is what I do. I have arrived at time 14. The old value of C is 1, and the new value of C is 1. There is no event, nothing has changed. Even if there was an event, nobody was sensitive to C, right? So no re-evaluation is required, okay? So C remains 1, okay? Notice A is 0, B remains 1 now, and C remains 1. Now what is the next transaction? At 20. At this time, at 20, make A equal to 1, right? So you make A equal to 1 at 20. So these are the old values at 14, 0, 1, 1. And at 20, you make A equal to 1. So A has an event, correct? A has changed. Who is sensitive to A? Both inverter and the NAND. So I must evaluate both of them. So what is the value of B? Because this is 0, B must become 1 at current time plus 8, right? What is the current time? 20. So I must schedule at 28 the value of B becoming 0, right? Input has become 1. Input has become 1 from 0 at 20. So the output should become 0 at 28. That is the behavior of the inverter, right? So therefore, at 28, make B equal to 0. When I do the NAND, what happens? A is 1 and B is 1. So the output should be 0. This is a NAND. At what time? At 26, right? Current time is 20 and the delay is 6. So at 26, make C equal to 0, correct? These two transactions I insert here and take off this 20 because I have already handled the 20, right? So at 26, make C equal to 0, at 28, make B equal to 0, and this 50 A equal to 0 remains, correct? All right, these are the waveforms. At A, we have had this transaction, and now my C has become 0 at 26. Right, that is the next transaction. So I advance the time to 26 and make C equal to 0. C has an event, but nobody is sensitive to C. Therefore, all I do is that make C equal to 0 and then advance to the next time. What is the next time? B should become 0, right? So I come to next time at 28, B becomes 0. 26, B was 1, at 28, B becomes 0. So B has an event. If B has an event, who cares? The NAND, right? So if B is 0, then 6 times of unit later, make it 1. So therefore, make C equal to 1 at 34, right? So we insert this in the time ordered queue. Next time is 34. I make C equal to 1. C has had an event, but nobody is sensitive to C. So therefore, C, which had gone to 0, now becomes 1. This is that glitch. We have correctly reproduced it. Okay. Next event is 50, A becomes 0. Right? That is the only thing left. When A becomes 0, both must be re-evaluated. Therefore, that means make B equal to 1 at 58 and make C equal to 1 at 56. Right? And take off this 50 transaction. Right? Both an inverter and NAND must be re-evaluated. So then at 56, C equal to 1, at 58, B equal to 1. Then I advance the time to 56, do the same thing, at 58, make B equal to 1, and this is my final. At when my transaction list is empty, then I have finished my work. Okay? So therefore, this hardware description language behaves differently. If you had just used assignments to C at the same time without this delay, you would have never got this glitch. And that is indeed the behavior of this hardware. You would not do it if you treated it like a programming language. Okay? And as a student, you would never understand why this glitch is coming in a hardware description language. If you wrote the corresponding C program, the C never shows. It always shows that the output to be 1. But it is only the hardware description language which will show this glitch. Okay? I think we'll stop here.